Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus came down with the 12 apostles and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases, and those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And all in the crowd were trying to touch him, for the power came out from him and healed all of them. Then he looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Humanity. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven, for that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets." The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the one holy and living God, amen. We got woes. We got woes. Anybody get a little itchy about the woes out there? We like Matthew's version. That's called the Sermon on the Mount. This is called the Sermon on the Plain. He went to a level place, Sermon on the Plain. And Matthew doesn't do this whole woes thing. He just does those nice blesseds. And don't we all feel so good about the blesseds? Ugh, we're so glad about the blesseds. We're so glad that people who have been downtrodden will be raised up. And we're so, right? We're so glad about the blesseds. But Luke's got us into these woes. And the woes are a little more uncomfortable, aren't they? Now, it might be in us that when we're hearing scripture like this, maybe we're able to sort of keep it a little bit out here, a little bit at arm's length, so it isn't kind of right in our gut so much, but it kind of needs to be in our gut a little bit too. We kind of really need to look at the both and that Jesus is offering us today and see what it means for our lives. So I think of it this way, and if you were at the Listening Till the Listening Starts Day a couple weeks ago, you'll have heard me talk about this a little bit, because it's one of my favorite things, about brain science and how we deal with words and how we deal with interactions, and I think somehow it applies to our experience, our emotional experience of hearing the blesseds and the woes. So here's the thing. Words are neutral. Any word that you hear or say, it starts out as a neutral thing. There is nothing assigned to it. It's not a good word or a bad word or anything. It's just a word. Until our brains get a hold of the words. And then our brains get a hold of the words and we tell a story in our brain about those words, or that combination of words, or that sentence, or that structure, whatever. We put a story on it. That can come from a whole host of things. That can come from our experiences, or our education, or some other kind of part of our background, or other things that have been assigned to those words. So for instance, if I say, I'd like to talk to you about something. That could mean some things, right? Depending on what story you've put on those words. Maybe that's how your mom started every interaction about something you did wrong when you were growing up. Or maybe you have a really good friend who liked to tease and joke that something big was coming, or a surprise or something, but they pretended it was serious, so it's actually kind of something you anticipate. There's all these, we put ourselves onto words, our lives and experience onto words. We tell a story about what they're going to mean. And then based on that, and that happens in a heartbeat. We're doing it all day long, left, right, and center. We're just assigning a story. There's all these brain connections that are happening all the time. It's happening all day. So then, depending on that story, then we have a feeling about what we've heard about those words. You know, we kind of had that nervous chuckle, I'd like to talk to you about something. It's because you have a story that goes with those words. So you have a feeling about that. Based on that feeling then, all of us, this is universal, we act. We act based on the feeling that comes from the story that comes from the words. Make sense? So the tricky part is that part two, where we tell the story, what the story is may or may not be true, because our brains are tricky. Our brains like to be clever and figure out what the story is before we have all the data to know for sure that that's what the story is about. So it may be that I come up to you and say, I want to talk to you about something. And it's perfectly, you know, innocuous. There's nothing big to it. But you go into fear mode, like, uh-oh, what'd I do? What's going on? What happened? But that's not actually there. So then you can't actually listen to the conversation because you're worried. See what I mean? So it wasn't true, but our brains told us it was true. So we always have this kind of big job to do as human beings interacting with people in the world, with this big job of discerning over and over again, is this just my stuff, or is there actually something happening here? Is this a story I've put on this, or is this a real interaction? So, all of that is to say, we need to do that with Jesus today too. Because for us, when we hear blesseds and woes, we assign a story to what that means. We assign a story to what it means to be the rich. Blessed are you who are rich. We've got a story for that. Blessed are you who are full now. We have a story for what it means to be hungry or not. We have a story for what it means to be laughing now and what it means to be weeping or mourning. We've applied over time our lives to these words from Jesus. Now, that's not necessarily a bad thing. It just means that we need to pick it apart a little bit more. It means that we need to dig in a little further and figure out, so is this just about my story, the feelings that I'm feeling about what Jesus is saying? Or is there something else? Because if we look at the beginning, way back here, Jesus is sort of just stating facts from his vantage point. These people will be blessed. These people who don't have much in this life, they'll be blessed. And those who have lots in this life, they've got their consolation now. It may be that those are just sort of facts to Jesus now, that the lowly will be raised And those who've been raised in this life might become lowly. So it invites us. How do we feel about that? How do we feel about our own lives in the context of this conversation that Jesus is inviting? Now, that could be hard. Again, that could be something we'd rather keep at arm's length. And we'd really rather just focus on those blesseds. But we can also focus on the woes and trust that Jesus is there with us too. I heard a quote recently, and I can't remember by whom, but to paraphrase, it's something like, we're all born in the image of God, but it's up to us to live into the likeness of God. And so there's this invitation for us to look, what would that mean for our lives? To live into the likeness of God. Not all of us have blesseds and all of us have woes. There is no just one way or the other. So to examine our lives, to go deep, trusting Jesus, that he's with us in examining and exploring with us who we are, who we'd like to become, how we'd like to be more in his likeness. This is the invitation of the blesseds and woes today. None of us is immune to either. There may be deep pains that you have in this life, and there will be blessedness for you. And there may be consolations you've received in this life, which means there will be something different. We don't know exactly what it all means, but it asks us. It asks us to look, to be unafraid, to really dig in, to do it alongside Jesus, to not just put our own stories on top of it, but see really what is Jesus calling us to. Where do we want to go? Who do we want to be? How do we want to live and love the kingdom of God? I don't have the answer for you. I may just barely have the answer for me, frankly. But we're all in it together. And there will be both and all the time for all of us. And so let's walk the road bravely, shall we? The blesseds and the woes. Amen.